Greetings! It is I, Tantus Naravan Dracovin, Lord and Emperor of the Dracovin Empire, and welcome! It's time to continue our discussion on the 5th edition of Dungeons & Dragons 5e D&D, and again, still on the same recording format for at least a couple more episodes. But let's dive back into 5th edition D&D because we have a few things to talk about today. I'm going to talk about the chase sequence, the idea of you going after someone or someone going after you, and of course siege equipment we're going to kind of finish up today with. Now let's start by talking all about chases. So if you're using the movement rolls in the strictest sense of them, a chase is pretty dull. If you're faster than the creature you're chasing, you're going to catch him. And if you're the same speed, you're never going to catch him. You're never going to close that distance. The rules that we're going to go over today are going to make chases more dynamic, more exciting, and introduce random elements. So when a chase begins, you have to define that there is a quarry and at least one pursuer. Basically, someone running away and some people going after them. If there's any participants that are already not in this initiative, you roll the initiative and create an initiative order. Just like in combat, you take one action and one move on your turn. The chase ends when either one complete side, when either the quarry or pursuer drops out, or the quarry manages to escape. When the chase begins, you kind of have to determine the distance between the quarry and the pursuers, and you keep track of that distance as things move around in it. The closest pursuer to the quarry is the lead, basically the person that's leading the rest of them. This lead can change from round to round. Now, the thing you're going to want to do most when it comes to the chase is a dash action. That's what you want to do most rounds. If you stop to cast a spell or make an attack, you could risk losing the quarry because you drop behind. And if you're a quarry that's doing that, more likely they're going to catch up to you. So you're freely going to be able to use your dash a number of times equal to 3 plus your constitution modifier. Each time after that that you use the dash action, it requires you to succeed at a constitution check at the end of your turn, DC 10, or gain a level of exhaustion. Meaning that if my constitution modifier is 2, I can take 5 rounds of dash actions for free before I have to start making a constitution check every round I dash after that. If your exhaustion level reaches 5, your speed becomes 0, you drop out of the chase. You can remove all those levels of exhaustion you gained during a chase with a short or long rest. That's important to note here. Now, a chase participant can make attacks and cast spells. Though you're advised against it, you certainly can to any creature within range. It's normal rules for cover, terrain, and anything like that for the attacks or spells themselves. When you're a chase participant, normally you can't make an attack of opportunity against each other since you're assumed to be all moving in the same direction at the same time. You're all making that run. So though I may run up and I might close that distance to 0, I'm assumed to be moving at the exact same time as the other people and therefore no attacks of opportunity. If I haven't made any difference, I might be within 60 feet of my target, doesn't mean anything. Now, that doesn't mean attacks of opportunity couldn't occur to participants. If something's not participating in a chase and tends to be the enemy of one of the two people, like if I'm an adventurer running away from a gang of thieves, and I run into some more of that thief's gang, they might make an attack of opportunity against me. Now, a chase ends when one or the other side stops, when the quarry gets away, or basically when the pursuers are close enough to catch their quarry. If neither side has given up the chase, the quarry makes a dexterity stealth check at the end of each round, after every participant in the chase has taken their turn. The results are compared to the passive wisdoms of the pursuers. If there are multiple pursuers, then everyone would make a check, just the same as there would be multiple creatures in the quarry, they would all make this check. If the quarry is not out of the lead pursuer's sight, this check fails automatically. That's the important note here. Though I get this dex stealth each turn versus passive wisdom, if I'm still within sight distance of the lead, it automatically fails. Otherwise, if your check as the quarry is greater than that of the highest passive score of those that are pursuing you, you escape. If not, another round of chase goes on. Now, it's possible for the quarry to gain advantage or disadvantage to its own checks based on circumstances. There's an escape factors table in the book just like any other circumstances, if you have more than one of these circumstances, like two advantages, it's still just advantage, or an advantage and disadvantage. They cancel out, you have neither. There could be other factors which would either hinder or help a quarry to escape at you as the DM's discretion. Something like a fairy fire might be make you, where you glow, might make you easier to see, therefore easier to spot, make it harder for you to escape. And escape doesn't mean that the quarry has outpaced its pursuers. That's the important thing about that. In an urban setting, it means that you ducked into a crowd that he couldn't pick you out of, slipped behind a corner quickly that they ran by in, leaving no clue that you went there. In any good chase scenes, there's complications arriving. It makes it more heart-pounding. There's an urban chase complication table and a wilderness chase complication table that both show examples. These events occur randomly. Each participant in the chase rolls a d20 at the end of their turn. You check the table to see which complication, if any, occurs. It doesn't affect the person that rolled the d20, rather than the next participant in the initiative order. Meaning that if I go in initiative before my ally that goes after me, basically I'm at initiative 10 and they're initiative 9, what I rolled on that d20 affects them. What they roll on the d20 affects the next person initiative after them. We basically are whispered down the line of complications. Though if you're using inspiration, the person that rolled this or the person that is going hit by this can either of them use inspiration and negate these complications. If a character has a really good idea for a complication that they could be creating, they could come up with their own one. At DM's discretion, it would be appropriate and adjusted as you see fit as the DM. Certain environments that you could encounter might work differently and might have some of these different complications, and you could make up your own charts. Now, sometimes creatures that are being pursued can split into smaller groups, kind of divide their forces, allowing some of the quarry to escape. The pursuit group then can split themselves up if they wish to, and either smaller chases, resolving each separately. If any kind of split up between characters on the quarry and on the chase side then as a result of that occur, you still do one-to-one rounds for all the chases at once. So I run a round of one chase, then round of the next chase, and so on, keeping track of the distance for each of those chases. So I run a round of each chase separately, kind of round robbing them. So each one would have their own initiatives, we go through each of them, but kind of you come up with your own initiative through these multiple chases, kind of moving through them, so you do split it up. It might be good for you to have a map of the chase, basically a rough map you put together that you could put obstacles and where they are along the chase, notes about things that might occur, things that your characters might have to avoid in order to stop themselves from slowing down or to even actually get stopped by it. You could use the random table of complications to come up with something similar or come up with something of your own in putting it together in this chase map. These complications that you're putting on here can be a barrier for progress. It can be opportunity for mayhem. These maps don't have to be linear either. It can have many branches depending on the nature of it. Having a chase through a sewer means there's many tunnels to turn down. Why a minecart, if you're going to chase in a minecart, it might not have any alternate paths, or it could have a couple of them. It is also possible during a chase that a pursuer could become quarry. One example might be if a thief is running through marketplace and your players are chasing after them. Another group from that thief's guild, a gang of them, could see this and get involved in it, chasing after the adventurers. So technically it's like two chases combined into one. The thief is being chased by your adventurers and the thief's allies are chasing after you. Another thing might be that thief might come up and meet with a bunch of their gang, and it would be too much for your player characters to overcome. They'd turn around and basically reverse the chase. So you'd become the quarry and they'd become the pursuers. Both could occur depending on it if your characters would decide to flee from a situation that they're vastly outnumbered. Now let's also talk about siege equipment today. These are basically used to attack castles and fortifications, take down cities, conquer places. It's meant to be based upon war, and campaigns that use war tend to use siege equipment. They don't really move around on their own in the battlefield. Creatures have to move them, load them, aim them, fire them for them to be useful. Everyone has an armor class, a number of hit points, and damage immunities that they have. They also give the basic attacks that these siege weapons would have, and some basic descriptions. I'm just going to go over the list of what they are, not really what they do. There's a ballista, a giant crossbow, effectively a cannon, is exactly what it sounds like. Uses gunpowder, but only really should have a cannon if gunpowder is within your campaign in somebody. like in Faerun, gunpowder or smoke powder, as it's called, was created by gnomes, so therefore cannons could be around Lantan. There's suspended cauldrons, the big cauldrons that are meant to boiling oil or some kind of similar liquid on top of those attacking. A mangonel is a type of heavy catapult. It does what it does, a horrible big stone. Ram is used to break down doors or other things that are blocking you. Siege towers are meant to get a group of medium or smaller creatures to the top of a big wall. And trebuchets are another type of catapult that flings a stone very far. Now, diseases are a threat that your characters can incur because of many reasons. There could be a plague in a kingdom where their quest is to find a cure. You could go into an ancient tomb and be exposed to some kind of disease, whether from a curse or from an undead that you would have to deal with, a wasting sickness. Or you could offend some kind of power that would cast a spell that would cause an affliction upon you. There's a lot of ways that diseases can occur. Many creatures that carry diseases that they would give you. There could be a small outbreak in an area that would drain your party's resources. Something like Lesser Restoration could recover from it. A complicated outbreak could be the basis of an adventure. That entire idea of a kingdom being under a plague and you searching for the cure. So the amount of people affected by a disease also makes it how important it is, whether it's a small group, only one or two of your characters, or a large kingdom. The idea would be to stop the disease from spreading and deal with the consequences of the diseases. Sometimes it might be as easy as quarantining someone to stop the spread of the disease, or just them not interacting with anybody, and it's just the consequences you have to deal with, especially if it's a more individually affected disease. A disease that affects a number of party members could become a plot device for you. The book gives the basic rules and the ideas of how a disease affects characters, but also how it can be cured, and how it works under specific rules. Now, diseases can affect any creature as long as it's what that nature of the disease is. A given illness might not affect or pass from one race or kind of creature to another, but it would affect any creature of that type. It also could affect any creature, period, depending on the nature of the disease. There could be a plague that affects undead, strangely enough, or one that only affects halflings but leaves other races untouched. Whatever story you're trying to tell determines what kind of disease you're going to hit people with. The book offers a couple of example diseases and how they work in the game. You're free to use those, affect the saving throw DCs, incubation times, symptoms, or other characteristics to suit your campaign. The three examples in the book are cackle fever, sewer plague, and sight rot. Read through them and it will describe how everything works with that disease, and it gives you an idea of how diseases work. I would definitely check an example. Just to kind of go over one and give you an idea, we'll talk about cackle fever in a bit more. It affects humanoids, though gnomes are immune to it. You get mad fits of laughter, shrieks almost. It manifests 1d4 hours after you've been infected with it, giving you fever and disorientation. You gain a level of exhaustion that can't be removed until the disease is cured. Anytime you have great stress, combat, taking damage, great fear, having a nightmare, has you make a constitution save. If you fail, you take 5, a d10, psychic damage, and become incapacitated with mad laughter for a minute. You can repeat the saving throw at the end of each turn to end the maddening laughter and the incapacitated condition, but you have to deal with that every time one of these stressful situations occur. If a creature starts its turn within 10 feet of an infected creature in the throes of mad laughter, you have to make a constitution save, or you also become infected in it. It's kind of a magic disease or supernatural disease, because if you hear someone laughing to this and you're 10 feet away from them, guess what? You can be affected too. If you do succeed on that save, it is only a DC 10 constitution save. You're immune to that bit of mad laughter for 24 hours. At the end of a long rest, an infected creature can make a constitution saving throw. If they make their save, the DC for getting that save again, or to save against the mad laughter itself, reduces by a D6. And when you drop a DC to 0, you've recovered from it. That's how you recover from it. So each time at the end of a long rest, I can roll the constitution save, DC 13. Succeeding it means I can drop it. At most, it'll take you 3 successes to get away with from it. If you fail 3 times on that saving throw, though, you get a randomly determined form of indefinite madness, which we'll talk about later. But that's the negative effect of failing a lot of saves of cackle fever. And that's the example, cackle fever. But that's it for today. So, I discussed the idea of the chase sequence, that you're not just going to use strict by the numbers, you're going to be more adaptive and throw these kind of twists in that make it something more interesting than a just, I run forward, I run forward, I run forward, I run forward, and whoever has the faster speed wins. That's boring. That's not exciting. And the point is to make every aspect of your game have a little bit of excitement, have a little bit of drama to it. And a idea of a chase sequence adds to that. You get excitement and drama from your combat, from your things you discuss. So why not make a chase, a run after another character kind of idea that happens in a lot of movies and TV series, exciting? And that's kind of what we broke down. And then I did talk, of course, about siege equipment. Now, this is an important one if you're getting into a more military or army-based game, whether your characters are part of an army, working for an army, or something dealing with armies and battles is around them that they have to act upon in a certain way. There are a lot of ways that armies and siege equipment can come into a game. You could also just be fighting a city versus a giant creature that's trying to attack it, some kind of large dragon or other beast that maybe siege equipment's required. There's a lot of uses for it, and learning how to use it and how your players might interact with it, especially if they're either using it or fighting against it, would be very interesting and is very helpful for your games. But anyway, I hope you're having a great day. Remember to, of course, like, share, subscribe, and comment. It all great ways to support the channel in the most easiest way. You can also check out all my links below, Twitch, to see everything that I put the VODs out for, Twitter, or Discord for contacting me and knowing more what's going on. And of course, my Patreon if you want to show some extra support and maybe see if I can get an editor to help with some more scripted videos just like this one. But anyway, until that next time, I bid you farewell.